Hi, my name is Sarah Zambor, and I'm a Board Certified Behavior Analyst with Brett DiNovi & Associates. Today, I'm going to be discussing extinction, which covers C3, D18, D19, and D21 on the BACB 4th edition task list. Cooper, Heron, and Heward define extinction as a procedure that occurs when reinforcement of a previously reinforced behavior is discontinued. As a result, the frequency of that behavior decreases in the future. While extinction can be an effective part of a treatment package when implemented correctly, there are a few things to consider prior to recommending it be used by parents, teachers, RBTs, or anyone else who may be working with the learner. 1. Understanding and preparing for an extinction burst. Lerman and Iwata define an extinction burst as an increase in frequency, intensity, or duration of the target behavior in the early stages of treatment. Extinction bursts have been observed in both humans and animals immediately after reinforcement has stopped. This phenomenon is especially true when a target behavior has been reinforced on a continuous schedule. Some authors have suggested that, due to the potential occurrences of an extinction burst, extinction should not be used as treatment for severe behavior disorders, while others suggest the burst might be reduced or eliminated by combining extinction with other procedures, such as differential reinforcement. Research is unclear regarding how often extinction procedures result in bursting or if reinforcement of operant procedures lessen this side effect. 2. Understanding spontaneous recovery and resurgence. Mayer, Sulzer-Azaroff, and Wallace, authors of Behavior Analysis for Lasting Change, define spontaneous recovery as the reappearance of the extinguished response at the beginning of a new session despite no resumption of reinforcement. The same authors define resurgence as the reoccurrence of previously reinforced behavior when a target or dominant behavior is no longer reinforced. Both spontaneous recovery and resurgence pose a danger to our learners, as some practitioners may attempt to move to a more intrusive treatment method if either occurs, when doing so might not actually be necessary. Having a deep understanding of both phenomenons just described is crucial before implementing any type of extinction procedure. 3. Intermittently responding during extinction. If a targeted behavior is intermittently reinforced, it is more likely to promote persistence to extinction. For example, if a student calls out inappropriate comments during class for attention, and that behavior is intermittently reinforced by staff or peers calling out inappropriate comments, is more likely to show persistence to extinction. In 2013, MacDonald and colleagues published the study Persistence During Extinction, examining the effects of continuous and intermittent reinforcement on problem behavior, in which they had similar findings to Lerman and colleagues in 1996. Both MacDonald and Lerman found that placing problem behavior on an intermittent schedule of reinforcement prior to treatment may reduce the likelihood of extinction bursts during treatment conditions, as well as minimizing resistance to change. 4, making sure the environment can tolerate any possible side effects of extinction. Before recommending that an extinction procedure be used, it is imperative that the behavior analyst analyze the environment as well as talk with all practitioners expected to implement the plan. The practitioners responsible for implementation should have a full understanding of what side effects may occur and should be coached by the behavior analyst until they feel comfortable implementing the procedure on their own. If the practitioner feels uncomfortable at any point during implementation, the procedure should be terminated and alternative procedures should be explored. If the practitioner is not willing or comfortable implementing an extinction procedure with the behavior analyst present, it is unlikely they will do so with no additional supports. Settings such as classrooms or learners' homes can be difficult to implement extinction procedures, as target behaviors are often either intermittently reinforced by peers, family members, school staff who may be untrained on the plan, those working with the learner are unable to tolerate an increase in the target behavior. If practitioners are unsure if they can implement an extinction procedure with fidelity, it is recommended another intervention be used, because if implemented incorrectly, they may end up inadvertently strengthening a higher magnitude target behavior. 5. Overuse of traditional escape extinction procedures. Traditional escape extinction is described as the use of repeated verbal prompts, often referred to as nagging, and/or forced physical prompts, to get the learner to comply with the staff directive. Both nagging and forced physical prompts can lead to a multitude of harmful side effects. These side effects include, but are not limited to, a damaged relationship between the learner and the practitioner, implementing the traditional escape extinction procedure, an increase in behavior intensity, reduced fight or flight responding in the learner, an increased rate of staff burnout. Oftentimes, traditional escape extinction procedures are implemented when the learners are young and easier to move or redirect. However, in using such procedures, appropriate replacement behaviors are often never taught. This is not only a major disservice to the learner, it also poses dangerous situations for both staff and the learner as the learner gets bigger and stronger and is no longer possible to physically prompt or redirect. One question to ask yourself before using a more traditional escape extinction procedure is, would you use this procedure with a neurotypical individual? If the answer is no, then I highly recommend you consider why you are using it with your learner. In 2017, Heward et al. Published a study titled Task as a Reinforcer, a reactive alternative to traditional forms of escape extinction. In this study, Heward and his colleagues tested the efficacy of a reactive extinction procedure they referred to as a waitout. The waitout consisted of a timeout from the opportunity to work, and therefore a timeout from the opportunity to access reinforcement. Reinforcement was only provided when work was complete. In Heward's study, waitouts were found to be effective in both reducing behavioral excesses and increasing compliance with non-preferred activities. A waitout procedure involves implementation of the following four steps in a systematic way. Step 1. In this step, the learner demonstrates at least one maladaptive behavior or verbal protest behavior, or fails to respond to an SD for at least 5 seconds. Step 2. During Step 2, the instructor presents a targeted S delta, for example, sliding a worksheet away from the learner or turning their body away from the learner, while simultaneously saying, "That's not ready," in a calm and neutral tone. Step 3. During this step, the instructor waits for the learner to demonstrate at least 5 seconds of relatively calm waiting and at least 2 seconds of orienting towards the instructor. When this has been achieved, the instructor asks, "Ready?" in a calm and neutral tone, while simultaneously moving work materials towards the learner. If the learner indicates readiness in any way, for example, nodding, saying yes, or refraining from any further protest while glancing in the direction of the instructor, the instructor presents work materials and attention. It is important to note the instructor is never forcing the learner to work and is entirely hands-off, which may look different from a more traditional escape extinction procedure. Step 4. If the learner escalates in any way after being offered the work materials, or if 5 seconds pass and the learner has not yet shown any indication of readiness, the instructor turns their body away from the learner while simultaneously moving materials away and returns to step 3. These steps are repeated until the learner has completed the task. When utilizing a waitout procedure, ideally the learner should wait at the table or work area and should be denied access to attention as well as other potential reinforcers. If it is not possible to keep the learner at the table or work area without extensive physical prompting, the learner should be allowed to leave the work area. However, the learner should not be able to access any reinforcers. Sanitizing the environment prior to the start of a session is crucial in the success of a waitout procedure. The effectiveness of waitouts depends upon the learner's understanding that the work will ultimately be required and that few, if any, reinforcers will be available until after the work has been completed. While a waitout may seem counterintuitive to implement initially, it can be a safer and perhaps more socially valid alternative to the more traditional escape extinction procedures described earlier in this video. Before using extinction in practice, it is important to be familiar with extinction's properties as well as how to use extinction effectively in various environments. While at first glance, extinction procedures may seem relatively simple to implement, it is imperative to ensure all treatment is both ethical and socially valid. I hope this video has been helpful in providing an overview of the more traditional forms of extinction, as well as a resource to explore recent literature regarding alternatives to the traditional escape extinction procedures. Please share this video and subscribe if you would like to further disseminate the science.